Hi, this is Max Stratton from Max BMW Motorcycles, and thank you for joining us for our R90S build project. What started out as a fun project between my brother and I to see how many parts were still available for an R90S in the BMW parts catalog actually turned into a full build and a real bike that runs and drives. First thing we did was to order the major components that we knew we'd have to have to really make this work, which was the frame, which was still available, the motor, which took 4 months to get, so that meant that BMW actually built the short block for the engine, and the bodywork. And the thing that was special about the bodywork for this particular motorcycle was this is the last set of smoke silver factory painted bodywork that BMW had in stock, and they're not painting this bodywork anymore because the paint mixture content has changed, but you can still get the bodywork in primer for the R90S. So that's something that's very, very special about this particular bike. Once we had those components through our restoration work and through our other service work we did, we kind of had a good idea of everything else that we could still get and knew that most of those part numbers that were in the catalog were still valid and they were still shipping those parts. So in the end, we many thousands of parts later, and about 2.5 days later, we produced a motorcycle. There were 5 used parts on this bike that we were not able to get new that are no longer available. And those parts are the swing arm, the rear brake lever, and the rear brake rod. There's a clip inside the airbox that holds the 2 airbox halves together. The tack drive and a washer for the tack drive is a little unit in there. And this particular bike has a electronic tack, which is not correct for an R90S, but that's what's available today for BMW. But we used an R90S front engine cover, and you needed to put that tack drive in to plug it up so it wouldn't leak oil. I hope you enjoy this video. You'll see many of these parts are updated parts because the whole key to this project was for us to make this out of exclusively parts that are available today from BMW. So some of these parts are superseded to newer style stuff. But what's kind of interesting is this bike's built out of the latest and greatest parts with all the updates. And it runs and drives beautiful. We have a great staff that helped put this together. It was a lot of effort from our parts department and all the stores to assemble the parts for the build. Thanks to all the technicians that helped build the components for the motorcycle. And, you know, we're always here to answer your questions. We're always here because we're excited about your projects. And as you have questions and needs and help, visit our website and contact one of our stores. Even if it's a simple how-to question, and we'll do the best to help.
Phil Cheney at Max BMW Connecticut. Here is Jeff putting in the steering head bearing races. All the paint is being cleaned out before the races go in. Now he's compressing the races together with our BMW special tool. Now we'll put the lower triple clamp in, or getting ready to put the lower triple clamp in, with the bearing on the lower triple clamp. Here's our bearing greaser.
Triple clamp bearings now to the steering head.
This way you don't have to do it by hand.
Has a baffle plate that goes on first to keep water.
Now this bearing right here will go on the lower triple clamp with the dust cover. Here Zena is putting in the roll pins for the vents for the gaiters. Since the gaiters aren't on the R90S, we wouldn't use the roll pins, but the roll pins are there on the lower triple clamp. Setting up the center stand and the frame, so we have a platform to work on. We've got the lower triple clamp on, the steering head bearings. And preparing to put the fork tubes. This right here is simple felts that you put inside the fork gaiters. They're wipers that are in there actually. Here we are setting up the forks. The lower sliders have to be absolutely precise so the fork or the wheel axle goes through and turns easily so there's no binding. Here Jeff is putting on the turn signal stalks that have to be wired. This takes three hands usually. This is where the roll pin that Zena has just put in locates those turn signal stalks. Here goes the wiring harness in now through the grommets. Upper triple clamp is being put on now with the fork springs. These are the holders that you see there that Jeff is holding. They're the holders for the front fairing stays. These all have to be torqued down to 75 foot-pounds, those 36, I'm going to call them 36 millimeter nuts because that's the tool you use on them. Zena is now setting up the disc brakes and the holders. This is important to torque these. And the specification, the torque specification is in your manual. It's somewhere around 18 to 20 foot-pounds, I would imagine. Zena built these wheels ahead of time because it would just be too much to do this online. It takes too much time, and she did a great job with them.
I know. I might just do that as a little graphic underneath everything that says, you know, crisscross pattern if we end up not using any.
Here we are completing the platform by installing the front wheel. Again, that axle has to go in nice and easy so it slips in with a push of the thumb and it turns easily by hand. There's our platform set up. ID tag being riveted on. Getting ready to put in the short block or the crankcase. The crankcase is put on before we put the pistons and cylinder heads and cylinders on, of course, so it's easier to handle. This came as a unit from the factory. Notice the connecting rods are tied up so they don't move around and hit on the case. You can see your double row timing chain there. In 1979, they changed that to a single row. Oil filter access plate is visible now. Springs are being set up for the center stand. The spring holders are part of the spacer for the engine in the frame. There's our side stand going together with the grease fitting on it.
Oh, look at that, huh?
Rubber mallets used. Nice and easy. Now we're setting up the headlight. All the grommets are being installed and the ignition switch. That's the inner ignition switch nut to hold that to the headlamp bezel. You can see the plate on the inside of the headlight now where all the wiring connects. Everything is color-coded. There we go with our torque wrench. Nice and easy not to mar anything.
75 foot-pounds.
Now we lay the wiring harness in on the platform, making sure it's routed correctly. Best thing for you to do is to get some pictures from the owner's manual and look at everything. You can see the color coding now on the plate. Here we are now connecting the turn signal harness. You can see the red and blue wire into the headlamp. Get all your wires set up so they're not twisted against each other, because that inner wiring harness has to be clipped inside the headlight so it's out of the way of the headlight bulb assembly and the reflector. Here we are now jumping to the clutch with the special tools to hold the clutch coming up soon. Put a little grease on the back of the pressure plate where the spring connects to it. Your pilot tool goes in to align the clutch plate. These are all BMW special tools. Once those are tightened down, then you can put three of your hold down screws in, remove the special tools, and put the last three in. Torque your screws to factory spec, which is, my memory serves me right, around 18 foot-pounds. We're using foot-pounds because this is old school. Snug everything down nice. And here we go with the torque wrench. Nice clean parts to work with. Here we're installing the starter motor. You can see the breather to the right. That's the new style reed valve breather. This bike would have originally had a little poppet valve, but this is the new one that's available now that comes with the engine. Side stand spring and side stand retainer clip that fits behind the exhaust pipe. In goes the transmission with the splines all greased. Once the splines are lined up, that pushes right in nice.
Beautiful.
Here we are with the four securing bolts. You can see the clutch arm and the push rod there in the back. That's the special retainer clip for the left side airbox. If that's not on there, the airbox will walk back and there'll be a gap in there you don't want. There's your pusher piece for your clutch push rod. Now the clutch arm goes on. Grease that pivot rod or pivot pin, and then you'll put your circlip on. Now your adjuster piece will go in after that. There's your output flange. Here we're installing the oil pressure switch now. Here's our breather cover going on. And the damper unit, or damping unit for the front forks. Make sure you install the locking clips that go on those rod ends. This piece right here that their hands are on has to be adjusted perfectly, or the damper knob won't align right up at the upper triple clamp. This all has to be greased. If you look on the face of the knob, there is a 0 and a 1 and a 2, and those have to be lined up perfectly. Here's a picture of the seat frame. The wiring harness will be run along the back of the seat frame for the rear turn signals, the brake and running light. Here we're setting up the seat lock. That can take 3 hands sometimes also. With the cover and the button and the inner spring, it's easier now because we have the seat frame off. Might be a good idea to use some Loctite on these long screws that go in there because they tend to back off, loosen up, and you don't want that to happen. This is an excellent water trap. Oh, here we're installing the rear brake light switch. It's easier to put the brake light switch in now and get it all set up and tightened. Here, Jeff is torquing the drive shaft bell. That bell will fit into a gear on the rear drive assembly. That drive shaft area there is filled with oil. Now you can see the bell that Jeff just torqued. Here we are installing the swing arm bearings. We've cleaned all the paint out from the inside of the swing arm bearings, and we're putting the plates and the races in now. What we're doing here is we're putting a little bevel on the inner edge of the area where the bearing race goes. That makes it slip in a little bit easier so it's not loaded. Grease the inside diameter a bit. Nice and easy does it with the hammer. To make it a little easier, you can chill that race in the freezer for a while. Should only take 15 minutes, half an hour. Now they're installing the seal. The greased bearing has already been installed. There's some assembly lube right here that we're using. Make sure that bearing race goes in nice and straight. It's easy to get it cocked. There we go. You can see the plate inside the baffle plate. And that's the sleeve that the seal rides on. Should be greased up very well. They tend to rust and take the seal with them after they rust. So the more grease you put on it, really the better it is. You can't put enough grease on that.
Who knows what's going to come in there if this was opened up. What we have here are the seals. Before you put them in the seals. It's a dirty job, guys, but somebody's got to do it, as they say. Now, we're waiting for the bearings to be greased. Can we radius this edge here a little bit with something? See how this is? Okay. Play our fingers to do this. Eddie was one guy who didn't die in a fiery plane.
Here we're installing the rubber. Now we're looking for Oben is what we're looking for, which is the top of the drive shaft boot. There's a little print on the top of it that says Oben, and that's top in German.
Yes, that's perfect. Thank you, Rusty. Don't ask me why.
Install the clamp with the
if anybody out there knows why,
screw
let us know.
Facing towards you so it doesn't interfere when you're putting the swing arm in the frame. If you put that screw at 6 o'clock, sometimes it interferes with the frame. It'll scratch the frame. It'll be hard to mate it up with the transmission. This is one of the only major parts that we couldn't get this swing arm. So if you're looking at the front of that rubber dust cover, it would be at 9 o'clock. Installing the pivot pins for the swing arm into the bearings. You want to keep approximately a 4.5 millimeter space between the frame and the swing arm on each side, and those pins get torqued down to about 7 foot-pounds, and the locking nuts that hold the pins in are about 75 foot-pounds.
And the frame.
Check your manual, though. Don't listen to me. Check your manual first.
But it's got to be even, and you usually end up with about 4.5 millimeters.
But the 4.5 millimeters of space between the swing arm and the frame, I don't think it's in any manual. But what you're doing is you're centering the swing arm in the frame. And 4.5 millimeters is approximately what we end up with. Sometimes it's 4 millimeters, sometimes it's 4.5 millimeters. But you can check it with a vernier caliper and see. The important thing is to get it centered in the frame.
27 millimeter cut socket.
If it's not centered, sometimes the drive shaft will actually rub on the inside of the swing arm, and you don't want that. Here's a grab rail going on. That also holds the left side cover in, so that doesn't fall off if the rubber bands that hold the side covers on happen to break or just go away. That grab rail pivots on the rear mount that is being installed right now. If you want to take that left side cover off, all you do is just take the forward bolt and nut and washers off and loosen that Allen that I'm tightening right now and pivot it up. Too many people try and force that battery cover off and break them, and they're getting more expensive every day.
Now I know we have that holder, the speedometer, instrument cluster holder that goes under there.
There's a throttle gear assembly being set up, synchronized, if you will, greased, ready to accept the throttle cables. There are marks on the two gear clusters, alignment marks. Pay attention to those when you're installing this. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Now we're installing the front master cylinder. And your brake light switch. Jeff just plugged in the wires for the front brake light switch. Inside the toolkit in the day was a set of feeler gauges and a little fork that you would use to adjust the cable on the master cylinder, the front master cylinder. I believe you can still order that cluster of feeler gauges and the little fork to adjust that through your BMW dealer. That fork fits in the back of the master cylinder plunger underneath that rubber dust cover. And you actually use the fork as a feeler gauge when you're adjusting the cable. Now, before you tighten that clamp down, you should bleed the system, because it's easier to bleed the system with a clamp off, because you can move the master cylinder, tilt it forward, sideways, as you're bleeding it to get all of the air out of the system. Here we're filling up the forks. I believe it's 280 cc's in that graduated cylinder for empty forks. 250 cc's if the forks haven't come apart to be cleaned, if you're just doing a service on the bike. Okay, here we are bleeding the system. We finally have all the brakes set up, the metal pipes down there, and Jeff is bleeding the system by hand without the lever attached. Thank you.
Now we have the lever attached. Clutch perch being tightened before we rotate the handlebars up. Clutch cable adjuster at the level is being installed now. Grease the ends of the clutch cable before you put them in the lever. There's a little felt there that needs to be oiled that Jeff is installing right now. It's a wiper felt for the cable that keeps the cable, helps the cable last longer. These cables have a Teflon liner and they last long enough as it is, but that felt just keeps that area from getting dirt in and fraying. Here we are wiping the brakes discs down now with brake clean. Get all the oil off them.
Never fail. No, this is why we do this.
You can see the older Continental RB replica tire on there.
Even new ones are dirty.
If it is a replica, it might be an original. Now these are the pivots that Jeff is putting in. They're eccentric pivots to adjust the caliper. You have a fixed pad on the inside of that caliper, on the inside of the disc rotor, and you adjust that fixed pad to the inside of the brake rotor. And you make sure that that pad is perpendicular to the rotor. Here we are installing the metal lines on the calipers. Okay, here we are setting up the brakes. You can see the felt on the outside of the brake rod there. That felt should be oiled. It keeps dust out of the mechanism. Needless to say, when you put the brake shoes on, you'll take that sticker off, the parts sticker. Clean everything with brake clean, even new parts. I like to put a little bit of grease on the brake cams. That's where the brake shoes pivot. Not a lot, just a little bit, just a smear with your finger. Sometimes it's good to have a small pry bar to get in there and pop the shoes out at this point because they are under spring tension. Sometimes they get caught on that little inner washer and you just have to pop them up and over it. Here we're installing the rear brake arm, rear brake pedal. That has a little spacer in there that goes between the frame and the pedal. You grease the pivot arm before you put it in. Then you have a lock washer that goes on and a locking nut. Anytime you pull the swing arm off these motorcycles, this has to come off, this brake pedal assembly. Anytime you take the transmission out, even though you're just pulling the swing arm back, it won't go back far enough to get the transmission out unless you pull this brake pedal off. Here's another view of the brake switch. Here Jeff is installing the last shock absorber. Looks like that sticker has been pulled off of the brake shoe. You want to make sure you get these rear shocks on right so the spring tension levers move the proper direction. They don't foul anything. If you have saddlebags on your bike, you don't want the levers to foul the saddlebags. There's a wide flat washer that goes on and then a spring washer that goes on before the nut goes on. Before the wheel goes on, the splines in the rear wheel are greased at the rear wheel. If you grease the splines in the rear drive, the rear wheel tends to push the grease into that little area and plug up the, there's a hole in the rear drive that it plugs up that would relieve oil from the rear drive area if the rear drive seal, the large seal, would go. So you put grease in the spline first, in the rear wheel, and then you'd wipe off the excess there before you plug it in. This isn't done, the splines will rust, and the rust will become abrasive and take the splines right out. Every time you change a tire, you should do that too. Clean the splines and re-grease them. Every little spline is greased. You don't want to miss one. One of the first things to rust on these machines in the day were the axles. So grease them up, wipe any excess off, but grease them so they don't rust. Since we're not using aftermarket parts, in the aftermarket you can buy stainless steel axles for these now. And that solves the problem completely. Look at how nice those new rims look. I usually leave the rear drive loose when I put in an axle like this if I'm building a bike, and then I tighten the rear drive afterwards. Here the front fork brace is going on now. In the real world, it's easier to have the front wheel off at this point, and then you can install the front fender and the little bolts that hold the front fender on underneath the fork brace a little easier. We were trying to do this in 2.5 days like we did, and sometimes we were rushing a little bit more than we should. But we got it done in the time allotted. Here we are wiring up the starter, installing the cap for the breather. Installing the foot peg rubbers, oil pickup and a pickup screen, little BMW universal sealant on there. These gaskets, oil pan gaskets on these bikes are so wide that they rarely leak. But you've got to be careful of these screws that hold the pan on, because they will strip if you're not careful, especially working on an older machine that's had that pan off several times. Here we're installing the battery box. It has 5 isoelastic attachments that go under it to keep it isolated from the frame and vibration. Here we're installing the cam followers, assembly paste on the face of the cam followers, oil on the cam followers themselves.
Can you get a close-up of inside the engine where the...
Here we're installing the piston in the cylinder before we install the cylinder assembly and piston on the engine itself.
Okay, now
a little lubricant on the small end, connecting rod bushing, wrist pin circlip installation. That rag is around the connecting rod bearing, so if the circlip happens to pop out when you're installing it, it doesn't go in the engine. Don't ask me how I know that. A little oil on the skirt before you slide the cylinder home.
In your application of cylinder base on these old twins if they're going to leak. Make sure. That's good. That's very good. Okay.
Head gasket only goes on one way. Lubricate the ends of the
that we put in earlier.
Push rods with engine oil. Lubricate the rocker arm needle bearings and the rocker shafts with engine oil.
Take.
Make sure the dot on the rocker shaft top is pointing towards you.
Okay. Notch forward.
Has the motor been rotated top dead center, or it doesn't matter?
The motor is right now at top dead center. Now, this is a boxer engine, so both pistons come up to top dead center at the same time. What we want to do is determine when we adjust our valves. We have great part support here. Cylinder head nuts are torqued incrementally to 25, between 25 and 27 foot-pounds. See how we're doing it a little bit at a time in a cross pattern. They have shims that go between the rocker arm and the rocker blocks. What we are going to do, we're going to determine how much clearance is in here, and we're going to add shims to that. There we are, bringing the cylinder up to compression top dead center to adjust the valve clearances. Standard clearances are 8 thousandths for exhaust, 4 thousandths for intake. Adjusted to the normal specification of 8 thousandths and 4 thousandths. Now, I'm old school, so I'm using thousandths. You guys that want to use. What we're checking now is a rocker arm end play. Now we're adjusting the valves. Checking rocker shaft end play again. Rocker arm end play again, I mean. Here we are lubricating the support bearing for the nose of the crankshaft. Installing the ignition coils and brackets. Dust boot for the spark plug wire, high tension leads. Here we're installing the isoelastic mounts for the diode board, or your regulator rectifier, as you'd call it in some bikes. We call it a diode board. That's what changes AC current from the alternator into DC current to charge your battery and operate your lights. When you're installing this cover, it's good to use a little heat around this area so the cover accepts the bearing, or the bearing accepts the cover. What you're doing is you're expanding the aluminum cover. Here's the ignition points and backing plate installation through the rubber sleeve. Make sure that rubber band on the outside of the ignition well that you're looking at is in there to keep water out. There are two types of Bosch grease you use, one on the ignition points, phenolic, the other on the inside of the centrifugal advance mechanism. There's a little felt there on the backing plate that you can put some oil on. Be very careful with this nut and spin the end right off if you're not careful. This is the alternator rotor being installed. Ignition points being adjusted, 16 thousandths of an inch. Alternator stator being installed with the brushes. Brushes can break very easily at this point if you're not careful with them. Here we are setting up the Delortos. The accelerator pumps are all set up.
beautiful.
The choke assembly is being installed. The accelerator pumps on the Delorotos are set up so you have about 5.5 to 6 cc's that comes out of the accelerator pumps into a graduated cylinder with 20 strokes of the throttle slide, full strokes. You can get yourself a small graduated cylinder and use that. Here we are routing the throttle cables. Here we are installing the rear fender. Washers on top. There are 4 rubber washers that go between the fender and the frame at this point. New starter housing being installed. Air filter. Choke lever assembly being installed into the left-hand air box cover. Notice the positioning of the clamps. Installing the fork lock at that point. Installing the instrument cluster.
Oh, you're looking for that red tie.
Here we are with the fuel shutoff valves or the petcocks. Here's Jeff installing the headlight. Jeff did all the electrics in this, in the headlight shell, plugged them all in, got everything right, didn't miss a beat. Now we're installing the header pipes and these clamps that I said that need anti-seize on them. If you don't put anti-seize on them, they will seize themselves to the cylinder head, and you'll have to cut them off. if you run into a problem with these and they won't come off, or they start to come off and stop, cut them off. You'll save yourself a lot of headaches. Here we are running the machine for the first time with an auxiliary fuel tank that Max just plugged in. And she started right up and sounds great. Sounds good. It's a go.
Okay, right. Shut it down. Very good. Very good. Okay.
Awesome.
Nice. All right, now we can. Oh, boy.
Seat going on the hinge pins, little lubricant on the hinge pins. Installing the clips on the hinge pins. Now these little rubber grommets that go over the turn signals here can be adjusted. They're eccentric, so you can move that fairing up and down to keep it away from the mirror stalks, so the fairing doesn't vibrate on the mirror stalks. Here you are putting the shrink tube over the connector for the turn signal. Turn signal lens is going on. White coming down. We're ready to put the windscreen on.
Finally has
a rubber water seal that goes around the inside. You can't forget that. This is a special tool for installing the plastic rivets. My name is Phil Cheney. I'm from the Connecticut store, and this is Jeff Frisch. Jeff is from the Troy, New York store, and we finished this yesterday afternoon for those of you who are watching. Started the machine. It ran great. Sounds great. And just finished putting fuel in it, as you could see. What we're going to do now is we're going to use our standard check sheet that we use in all the stores to go over the bike from front to back. So let's get the check sheet, Jeff. This is what we use at all the stores. After every machine is finished, the technician goes over the bike with this sheet, and then he calls another technician to go over it again. This ensures we have no mistakes.
First thing we'll check is the high beam. Low beam.
Check the tail light. You got a tail light. How about a brake light? Front brake.
Uh-huh.
The rear brake. Okay, let's try our turn signals, our right turn signal, left turn signal. Okay, everything's working. How about a horn? Do we have a horn? I guess we do. We want to check the warning lights. We want to check the illumination lights in the motometer instrument cluster, and they're all working. Okay, what else do we have on the list here?
Some of
what's on the list is superfluous because it's used for more modern motorcycles. So what we want to do now, we want to go around and we want to check the oil drain bolts, the oil filler plugs, check the engine oil, things like that.
Check for any leaks.
Check for any leaks, absolutely. So why don't we raise the table up, Jeff,
okay,
and we'll check everything underneath the engine. Okay, we're going to need an Allen socket for the drain plug. We're going to need a 19 millimeter for the drain plugs on the engine and the rear drive. We're going to need a 17 millimeter wrench for the drain plug on the drive shaft, which is an oil holding housing. Okay, there you go. You want to check the swing arm. Make sure the swing arm is tight. The wheels and all the wheel bearings are tight. You want to go around and check all the axle pinch bolts. Very important. Make sure all the axle pinch bolts are tight. Okay, here you go here, Jeff. There's your tools for the transmission.
Go ahead and just make sure they're all tight. The engine oil.
Mm-hmm.
All checks out.
Okay. We'll get a 10 millimeter wrench to check the cover on the oil filter housing.
Drain plug for the gearbox. That's tight.
Looks good. Looks good.
Go to the other side here. Oh, they switched that on us, Phil.
Did they? Okay. Good. Let's get a long Allen with a round nose on it. Here, I think there's one in the toolbox right over here. A ball end Allen.
Tight.
Mm-hmm. Very good. Check the final drive. Check the drive shaft.
The upper and lower bolts.
Everything's tight. Rear drive filler plug. And let's check the Delorto carburetor float bowl lower caps. These are the main jet access caps. This is a 21 millimeter. It's a special tool that you wouldn't normally use on a BMW of this vintage. Okay, let's check the other side. Okay.
It's all tight there.
Now, let's see what we've got here for free play for the front brake. Nice free play on that front brake. What about free play on the clutch lever? Free play is the amount that the lever will move before you can feel the cable.
Check
looks very good.
Play in the rear wheel.
Yep. Yep.
Nice and tight.
Mm-hmm. Let's get that sheet and we'll check off what we have already gone through. Let's see if there's anything else. Pinch bolts, I checked. Let's do this. Let's check the tire pressures because that we didn't check yesterday. So we'll check the tire pressures. We would normally check the brake condition on all of the bikes that we run through the shop, but we know these are brand new brakes, so we don't really, we can see them, they're new. The shoes in the rear are new, everything's new. It's amazing to think that this motorcycle, 2.5 days ago, was in plastic bags.
At 34 in the front.
Mm-hmm. Okay, that should be 32. Let's bring that down to 32 then. Our parts people did an amazing job here coordinating everything. This was no easy task for them. What do we have there, Jeff?
34.
We should up that 2 pounds then to 36. Now, what we would normally do, we would heat cycle the engine several times, put about 100 miles on it, and then retorque the cylinder heads and readjust the valves. At that time, because this has points ignition, we would also check the ignition timing. Over the course of break-in, the points rubbing blocks on these old machines would wear down slightly and close the points, retarding the ignition timing. So we would want to open the points again if need be and reset the ignition timing. If anybody attempts a build like this at home, I strongly suggest you do that. What Jeff and I are going to do now is we're going to check our work a little more in depth. We're going to take the fuel tank off and we're going to check the routing of the wiring harness. Just double check everything. We haven't really had a chance to do that, and I think it's time now. What we're going to do is we're going to lower the table at this point, pull the fuel tank off, open the seat, pull the fuel tank off, and check the wiring harness, and you can get up close on that.
Moving up a little bit more for the audience. We'll punch in the corner of the seat over the web. Good.
The wheels were built in this shop by Zena Foster. She did the wheels for us, did a great job. We were supplied with an original tool kit, an original shop towel. All these are still available from BMW. All the fairing hardware is all available as it was, right down to the molding strip. All the paint is factory paint. We didn't paint anything. Everything came like this from the factory, and it's beautiful, absolutely beautiful. Okay, here we go. Can we get a close-up of this area here?
I can on my camera, but the drop cam will just have to, just has the wide shot.
Sure, okay.
But we can see over there behind on
okay.
the table.
Now, Rusty has supplied us early this morning with some special clamps that we're going to install to hold this on here. They're little rubber pieces that go around, metal or stainless steel clamps that will bolt right here. We'll be doing that at a later date. But you see the ground strap is tight, right? Here's our switch 12 volts going into the coil pack. We have the original coupling here, and we were able to get the original red tie wrap. This is our starter protection relay. It's also a horn relay. It's called a protection relay because once the engine reaches a certain RPM and the alternator light goes out, you can't accidentally hit the starter button and engage the starter and ruin the teeth on the flywheel. These came out actually in 1970. They've been using it since then. Everything looks pretty good. The routing's good. Okay. We had to use high tension lead spark plug cables post 1976. These are all that is available really now, 1977. Yep. Maybe we should tighten these up a little bit. These are the Allen screws that hold the other coil strap on. They need to be tightened up a little bit. They look like they are somewhat loose. We have the ignition point lead on the other coil, on the other 6-volt coil. These are 2 6-volt coils wired to be used as a 12-volt. You have a wasted spark on a BMW. One side comes up to compression, top dead center fires. The other side fires at overlap. That's the way these were set up, 2 6-volt coils. So we've got our trigger lead to the ignition on this side. And we also have a lead for the electronic tachometer, which the R90S never had. It had a cable-operated mechanical tachometer. But this is what you get nowadays. This is what you can get. Motometer that made the instrument clusters out of business now. So it's very hard to get parts for these. And we couldn't get the motometer clock and voltmeter for this. They're just not available. VDO makes replicas, but they're not even close replicas. So yeah, I think so. I think we're fine. Yeah. Anything else that the boys think we should go over?
No, I think that's a pretty good checkup.
Is it? Okay. Yeah, we covered the list. Are lists available for the general public?
Yes.
I think it would be a good thing for everybody to have.
Hi, I'm Max Stratton, and this is a kind of a fun and crazy project, and you guys aren't going to stand behind me?
We will.
You can't leave me the only one on the camera. So any case, so this all started a couple years ago. I think it was probably a snowy day sometime in December. We were just goofing around in the parts catalog on the BMW parts fiche. Actually, it was on our website, and picking out how many parts were actually still available for vintage motorcycles, since we do a lot of restorations, and we always decide to replace or restore what would be most cost effective and stuff. So we started just putting together, and we decided we picked the model of bike after an R90S and see how far we could go. And we went pretty far on paper, and it just looked like this. And we didn't think that was a whole lot of fun, and so we thought the true test would be to see if we could actually get all the parts that they said they were still available, and if we could actually put the motorcycle together and see and make it run. And we did. And probably the most questions that we've been getting from everyone is how much and how many parts and did you really make it all out of new parts? And we actually did, except for 6 parts. So there are 6 used parts in the motorcycle. We could actually have a contest, or should we tell them? We'll tell you. All right, so the used parts that were on this motorcycle is the swing arm. That was not available new. So this whole project started based off of a used swing arm. The rear brake lever and rod, which we won't move the camera, but it's over here. That's not available anymore. The right front fork slider is no longer available anymore from BMW. So we have a new left and a used right. But we did find two, they're off an R100 RS, right, Rusty? So we found two black new ones that are coming in from Germany that will be here next week. So we'll talk about it some more. You may see two black fork legs on this motorcycle, so we can say we only used five used parts on this motorcycle. The clip for the airbox, there's a spring clip underneath here that goes on. That's not available. And the tack drive and the washer that holds the tack drive in is not available any longer. This bike has an electronic tachometer on it, not what the R90S had. And the front cover is still from a 90S, so it still had the hole for the tack drive. So we had to plug that up somehow.
That would be this, right here.
Yeah. So underneath there, there's a drive to keep the oil from pouring in there. Other than that, did you get the number, how many parts there are? We didn't get that. And the biggest question was the grand total.
Oh boy.
Rusty?
Oh boy.
Come on in. You gonna tell the grand total?
The introduction.
Just say hi. All right, so the grand total. We're still working this out, so we'll have a final, and we'll publish this up on the internet site so you can see everything. But as of right now, we have a few parts over there in the that might have been extra, so we're going to clean up our parts list some more. But right now, we're at just a little north of $46,000 in parts.
Woof.
So it can be done. A little expensive.
And we're not talking about labor.
Yeah, we didn't talk about labor. There was a lot of...
And everything else is wrapped up in that.
Yeah, so... we didn't really build this with any cost in mind. We just wanted to see if we could do it and take it from paper to the finished product.
Call us crazy.
Yeah.
This is what we do.
Yeah. So we're going to put the tank back on. We're here in New Hampshire. The weather's about 40 degrees out, or going to be about 40 degrees and sunny today. Unfortunately, the roads are pretty salty. So we're going to kind of do an indoor-outdoor test ride with this bike this afternoon. We're going to do some more checks on it, and we're going to test drive this thing. And we'll get some video footage of our test ride. You can see how it goes down the road, see how it performs. And yeah, that's about it. So you guys got anything you want to add? Or
Maybe the folks out there want to hear it run again. So maybe the folks out there want to hear it run again before we... close the door here. So we'll put the fuel tank back on.
Okay.
And light her up. Okay, yep. Jeff?
I'm ready.
Okay.
Yep. And I really wanted to thank everyone for watching. The feedback that we were getting on the Facebook page and all the other blogs and websites was incredible. So your support and your enthusiasm for what we're doing makes it so much more fun for us because as you can see, we're here having a good time, and we were really glad we were able to share this with you, and that means a lot to us. So I just want to say thank you, and we were getting people from all over the world. So thanks for spending your time, and hope you didn't get any in trouble at work for watching this all day. So we're gonna leave the live feed on. Things may or may not be happening too much, but we're gonna roll this off and test ride it, and we'll sign out a little later, and we'll have a finished product video. We'll post this up on the website. Again, you can email any of us here at the company if you have questions. You can ask questions on Facebook. We're happy to answer. And thanks again.
Okay. Can I ask you where some of our watchers were from? How far away?
We had Australia, Saudi Arabia, Germany.
Wow.
Oklahoma.
Wow.
So,
okay.
No, there's people all over. So,
that's quite a ways away.
That's exciting stuff. So. All right.
Good.
Thank you. Thanks. Sorry, we're back again.
Okay.
1,655 parts right now. And can you grab the luggage? Rusty, could you grab the luggage? We'll put it on later. But for the first test ride, we didn't want to go out with the luggage and get it dirty.
Trouser luggage and racks.
Well, let's put some rondelles on there.
Yeah.
With the bag mounts.
Rusty, you did a great job.
Yeah. It was a lot of fun.